Welcome to the Record Night Podcast. I'm Collin, joined by Jake, Joe, and Kyle. Record Night is a podcast where we listen to vinyl records in their entirety and then attempt to have a discussion about it. Thank you so much for tuning in. We hope you enjoy.
Every one of my records means something. The label, the producer, the year it was made.
Make sure you have the record player on at night.
All right. So, it's Friday night. Everybody knows what that means. It's record night.
Here we are.
Okay, so last week was Tom Morello. Bit of a change of pace this week. Well, before we get into Demons and Wizards specifically, which is the record this week, Jake said something. When we listened to Led Zeppelin, the part of them being considered the godfathers of metal came up, and Jake disagreed. Yeah, I guess we all kind of disagreed with that a little bit, but... Jake said something I hadn't really thought about, which is that metal has its roots in classical music, you said. I had never thought of it that way, but I talked to Kyle about it, and it kind of expanded on that. So what do you mean by that? I had never
When you look at like solos, like metal solos, the best way I can describe it is this, and this is the way I've always thought about it. If someone did a cover, if instrumentally, like a different kind of instrumental cover of like a rock and roll song, like that's why you can do covers of like hard rock songs like acoustically, like on an acoustic guitar a lot. Because it's like rooted in blues, whereas I think like Serge Tankian, for example, like a metal song, which that record we listened to, which one was that?
Yeah, it's just called like Live with the Auckland Philharmonic or whatever.
No,
I mean,
was,
is that the one
Elect
you're talking
the Dead.
About?
Elect the Dead's like a metal album, but just the way it's written, it lends itself way more to being remade in a classical setting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, just everything about it, the solo style, it just reminds me of, like, strings or, like, a fucking old, like, Beethoven, like, solo. Like, very abstract, not as, like, bluesy and hook, not as many hooks, not as bluesy.
That's really what it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's a focus on speed playing, but making sure you're unique. So it drives each player to build this very strong identity. And so when you're listening to them play, what they're playing are just arpeggios and different repetitive patterns as fast as they can, or like breaking it up with these huge, you know, overtures in their playing, or making sure that they're, or rather ensuring that what they're playing is theirs and theirs alone, despite it being the same arpeggio that might have been played 101 times or thousands or tens of thousands of times over the course of history, you know, since some of the great, like Chopin and stuff, like they still make it unique. And I think that's what I really like about it. You have some of the best guitar players in the world, like Yngwie Malmsteen, who is a metal guitarist, but he is a classical guitarist by training. Mm-hmm. His bizarre, you know, OCD training, but that's what he specializes in. It's classical guitar.
Yep.
Is that how most of them are? Like, is it common for them to have a background in like classical music as opposed to like rock and roll early? Like,
yeah, like opera. A lot of them are like operatically, is that a word? Operatically.
Yeah. Hans Kursch, the gentleman that we're going to listen to singing tonight.
Serge Tankian, opera.
Mm-hmm.
They're all, or at least like professionally trained singers and obviously that shows in his voice. Like, whereas like I think like rhythm and blues is more like almost the opposite of that. It's despite how similar they sound with like the same instruments are played, but the sound is completely different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All rhythm right. And blues.
Mm-hmm.
Well, or a certain rhythm and red. R&R. Too confusing with rest and relaxation.
Mm-hmm.
So Demons and Wizards specifically is a side project of two guys, correct?
Mm-hmm. Blind Guardian's Hans and Iced Earth's Hans. Guitarist John Schaefer.
Okay.
And they're both marvelous. This is particularly cool because John Schaefer is an awesome guitar player, and he does exactly what Hans does with his lyrics and singing. It's he does it to like evoke the emotion that Hans's lyrics are trying to evoke.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just it's, so you'll see, hear that playing, and they do such a great job. They have a new album releasing February 8th. This will be the first album in 15 years that they released together.
Wow.
So their new one will be the first one in 15 years. This is their first album they ever did, correct?
Year 2000, this one came out. 2005 was The Crimson King. That is an awesome album. It was so difficult trying to determine which one to bring because they both were remastered. Both have amazing songs on it. My favorite song is on this album, but my second favorite song is on the other album. The second album is more... It has a stronger focus on like literature, like their lyrics being based on literature and things like that, whereas this one's more about... You see a lot of lyrics... about German myth.
Yeah.
Is a big focus, like even like the Pied Piper and things like that. You'll see come up in here. And Nibelungs, the German dwarves, like that's a big focus in here and things like that. So it's just, it takes you on a wonderful journey. It's strong roots in folk. Hans, most of his lyrics are like very, it's all about the story. That's what's so wonderful about him. These guys are like the best version of power metal. I don't like power metal very much, but Blind Guardian, and the only reason being Blind Guardian is like the power metal band that I only want to listen to, and it's because of their lyrics and how wonderful Hans is. I find power metal kind of corny in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I understand what you're trying to say.
Yeah, we were talking about that the other day. Do you like power metal, Jake, generally?
I'll listen to some power metal. I mean, it's not like constantly in my rotation, but I have like In Flames is a good like power metal band. They're kind of like death slash power metal. If metal's a weird thing, man. It's so mixed. Yeah. It's so diverse. And then you have like these singers that can scream death metal verses and then go into like professional sing style, like fucking sing a ballad and shit.
He does a great job of that if you're ever interested. Into Eternity. How did you just like go from that low guttural like nothing that can be maintained for long, and then go to this beautiful voice? It's like that's very well.
It's got to be hard to do.
I wouldn't try it.
No. So Kyle, if you want to pull out the second record actually, so you'll excuse in the lyric packets I did, for the last song, I put down I listed Etching. And I said it was an instrumental track, but that's not the case. They literally meant there's an etching.
There's a literal etching.
On the D side of the record.
Fuck? Whoa.
You see it?
What are the lyrics?
You need to hold it to be able to...
No. It's just an image.
Oh. What the fuck? That's
It's like arc.
That's amazing.
It's the fiddler.
That's cool.
Death.
So it's just an the A. Needles, so like... it's just an A, B, and C.
Yeah.
Side, right?
Correct.
I think this is the second album we've done that's just been A, B, C.
Yeah, I think, yeah. Yeah, there was something else. It wasn't like an etching like that, but it was something on the back, like just a picture or
nothing.
Something.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it says side D etching. And so I'm like, oh, okay, wow, they finished with just one instrumental track. All right, that's interesting. But it's not a track, just just a literal etching. So,
to be fair, etching in German is solo track, instrumental.
So... You mentioned that's exactly what I had said right before the podcast started. Actually, is I was talking about how they kind of reference old stories and stuff. So the Pied Piper's one. Let's see, how many tracks are on this? 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, they're numbered, so I don't have to count them up. 8, 13. So there's 13 tracks. And this is from the Demons and Wizards Wikipedia page. Heaven Denies. One of the songs is based on Paradise Lost from John Milton. Poor Man's Crusade is just about the Crusades.
Nice.
Fiddler on the Green. That's got a very interesting story to that one, both an old story and like a real thing that happened to, I don't know if it's Hans or Schaefer, but...
I think it's Hans.
Okay. Oh, yeah, you're right. It says, what's his last name, Kursch?
Yes.
Winter of Souls is about King Arthur and Mordred.
Cool.
Blood on My Hands is based on Wagner's version of Siegfried's story as told in The Ring Cycle. So again, just old, like, German folklore.
German dwarves.
And then The Whistler, Pied Piper. So, I ended up down the rabbit hole, like, looking this up. I was, like, reading about the Pied Piper. I didn't know anything about the Pied Piper.
He led the rats down the
streets. Yeah, yeah. See, I didn't even know that. I just, you know, it's as famous a story as you can find, but.
Famous Megadeth song, Colin, you failed me.
This gives you a very graphic image of what happened in the Pied Piper. It's very.
Do you hear Megadeth is coming back?
Version of it.
I'm very surprised, considering that Dave Mustaine is recovering from cancer.
Yes.
Megadeth.
Oh, and also, I don't know if you guys heard another.
You
want
to talk about Megadeth?
We lost arguably the best drummer of all time today.
Who?
Neil Peart died today.
Oh, really?
Yep.
What did he die from?
I think old age. I think he was 68.
Dang.
What a way to die.
And Rush was talking about coming back too. Now they're not going.
Well, they did their farewell tour.
Yeah.
Certainly for a rock star, though.
Yeah. But
my drummer too. All the
he's amazing.
My uncle retired from drumming because it's so
rigorous.
Rigorous, yeah.
That's crazy, man. We were just talking about Neil Peart, a couple weeks ago with the Led Zeppelin. I mean, I know he didn't play for Led Zeppelin, but
oh, you're discussing like the greatest drummers, yeah.
Right.
John Bonham, what a beast.
He was a beast.
Okay. So, are we ready to rock and roll here?
I'm ready. We're ready to metal.
Okay. We're ready to power metal. Yeah, cool. I suppose it makes sense why I wouldn't see it on the lyrics page.
There's no lyrics. We're like marching.
Yes.
The ending of that was nice.
Took him to what you want.
That was a sick song.
Yeah, I love that song.
And the side A, I guess.
Yeah.
Thoughts so far?
Well, with that last song, I think Fiddler on the Green itself is like an old folk tale. Like with that name, the Reaper makes a mistake and takes him. Like I think that's, you know, obviously it's based on a true story too. But
yes, the Reaper makes a mistake and takes the life of a little child, and then I think Hans witnessed a car crash while he was touring or something along those lines, and took the life of another child. I believe it was. Is that what you read?
Yeah.
It was very impactful on him.
Well, what I read was it was a car crash that like killed a little kid, and then like a week later or something, he saw another in this like the same spot another
car crash
accident that took a girl. So that's kind of like the what he did that, you know, the poor kids, the poor boy is all alone. So do you mind if I take you too, sort of, you know, thing.
Oh.
A what trick of light turned cool red story. Into green. Mm. Yeah, the idea of, you know, how could somebody, or what caused the crash type of deal.
Red into, oh, okay.
Or how he caused the, you know, whatever the case might be. You know what he did to rectify his wrong.
Her body
killed.
Smashed.
He just killed someone else too.
Well, we'll get back to it, but what about the...
Very big song.
So we had the instrumental lead in, and then Heaven Denies. That's the one that's about Paradise Lost. Or at least based on Paradise Lost. Another good song on this subject is High Summer by Van Morrison. Also about Lucifer being cast out of heaven.
What was it called?
High Summer by Van Morrison. I didn't. To me, it was apparent right away you talked about the guitar matching the lyrics or like the tone he's trying to get across. I definitely got that in that song because it had. Cool. That's the one that kind of it changed at the end. Like it was real power metal and then kind of went down at the.
I really liked the change at the end there. I thought that was really cool. It shows their like their range of like what they could do.
Yeah.
Poor Man's Crusade did the same thing where it was, you know.
Yeah.
Like opened really hard and then finished really soft.
Yeah, that's my favorite song so far.
Poor
Man's Crusade.
Sorry. Nothing softer than Millennials, but nothing was harder than the Crusades.
It was a nice touch to those, I don't know, church-like is not really the right
like
word.
Church choir.
Yeah, it's a good touch given the subject material in that song.
For sure.
Yeah, that's why I like, because the whole, just the subject material of the Crusades, like how, like, we're doing this for God.
Yeah.
But we're going to kill thousands of people. But it was just like these greedy, like, kings and... You know,
the
these
Pope.
Leaders, you know, just like, yeah, let's just take out those people and take out those people. Yeah, it's just, but it's all in the name of God. Like, we're all doing this for...
Yeah, how did they not see the irony? In that,
yeah.
In that, you know.
Or rather, they probably did. How did everybody else not see the irony?
Right.
Yeah, how stupid were
because
they?
Because they were dead.
They were dead.
They killed
the
them.
The crest of light compels me, not my mind. Even holy and bright, he's a devil in disguise, protector of the cross, beware of the snake. It's the Pope, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Son of a bitch. You see the Pope smack that lady?
No.
Oh, yeah. That was funny. That was funny.
Chastising her right there in front of the world.
What'd she do? Like, was she like just
grabbing and pulling at him?
Oh, he's like, just get off me.
So the Pope started smacking her, and the his Secret Service detail, whatever the Vatican Guard. Nonchalantly allowing this to occur.
Yeah.
Crazy lady.
I was gonna say, let's can that guy.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Oh, the Pope has groupies. The
Pope has groupies.
Yeah, lots of them.
That was just his bottom bitch.
Yeah.
But Daddy.
Oh my God. In Fiddler on the Green, I really liked the obviously it picked up at the end, but just the acoustic sound of it.
Oh yeah.
Throughout, it just made me think like, man, this is an underutilized thing in music, just generally, like a really badass like playing the acoustic guitar like that.
Yeah.
Because it gave me the same reaction as like a solo. You know what I mean? Yes. Like a big electric guitar solo would have.
There was a nice solo in that, like in like right in the middle there. There was a really nice acoustic guitar solo.
Right after If I Take You.
Yep.
The ominous guitar right at that point, kind of in the background, like the electric guitar is just in the background,
it's like fading,
barely.
Like
yeah.
Slowly
getting yeah.
Louder.
Like yeah.
Humming, like yep. Building up. Yeah, it's a very well. It's the type of song that's. It's so simple, But that's what makes it so amazing. Like, yeah. It sounds effortless.
Mm-hmm.
Just everything about it comes together.
Henry. So can someone give some background to like the Pied Piper story, like what that song is actually about?
There was a town plagued by rats. This is my knowledge of it. There's a town plagued by rats,
the town is Hamelin, I believe. The Pied Piper of Hamelin.
Um, ah. And the Pied Piper was employed to clear the rats. I believe he said, "I can do this, but you must pay me." And the townspeople didn't pay him. So they, you know, fair price was set, a deal was fixed, it did my part, and they betrayed. I cleared their problem, but I trusted lies. And so he led all their children away.
Oh.
And in this song, say, I don't know if the actual story is.
That's what I'm talking about.
The rats, because I believe he.
The clan.
I believe he led the rats into the river in the. Drowned the rats in the river in the
Correct.
Story, but this is saying, nope. Food for the clan.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
The glorious race of rats and, like, the queen of the rats.
She will be pleased.
Her pale, cold eyes are watching over me. I'll never felt alone. All the children for her glory.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. The queen will be happy. Yeah, that's one of my favorite songs. It's a good story. By the way, these are fantastic beers. There's chocolate.
Yeah, let's give a shout-out. We're all drinking. Jake brought it. Imperial Cosmic Cocoa from Sibling Revelry. So, I'm a huge fan.
You've brought this before, haven't you?
I have.
This is the one I liked.
Yeah. And I wasn't a fan. I wasn't into it, but I really wanted a strong, like, stout.
Yeah, this is definitely, and certainly it's definitely that.
It's an interesting label on the can here. It looks like it feels like a sticker.
It is, and it's very different than other labels are all, like, real plain.
Yeah.
Like, usually just all, like, that, like, this plain font and, like, a symbol. Just some kind of symbol.
I've never seen a sticker on a can.
All right. Blood on my hands. Anybody have any thoughts there? I like the opening, and as I bear my inner soul, I've kept it hidden and safe. Interesting. I mean, so this is about, was this the King Arthur one? No.
Winter of Souls is King Arthur.
Yeah.
Blood on my hands is about the story of the Nibelung, the mighty dwarven, German dwarves.
Okay. That's the one.
It's just the story of that. Like, they talk about the River Rhine and things like that. And that's what I believe it's about. I like, this song has a really good lick at the end where it's just like, John, it's not even a solo. I don't even know if you could call it a solo. It's just a really cool little, like,
yeah, just right at the end, right?
That was very, you all know. You know.
Yeah. Beep, bop, boop, beep. Beep, beep, boop.
You heard it too. Perfect. But it so many of their solos and all their little licks and, like, these little hidden gems that they have in throughout their all their songs, like, most of their solos, I think Path of Glory, there's a solo right in the middle of a verse. Like, the verse just cuts off and a solo.
Yeah, that song was awesome.
I love,
And that's a fantastic song. It's just a great message. Come join me on the Path of Glory. This is what I, this is how I join, you know, this is my Path of Glory.
Yeah, I feel like the subject matter wasn't really too deep, like, too dense, but it got the point.
Yeah.
Like, it definitely gets the point across of, like, what they're trying to say. It's a simple message that they're trying to say.
Dispel your fears.
Yeah, they still did it, like, in their lyrical style and everything, but yeah, it was pretty straight up tune, you know, just.
Instrumentally, I thought that's, like, their best so far.
Was that the one with the blues of their best solo?
Yeah, that was my favorite with the fiddler.
Was that the one with the blues solo?
Yeah.
The glory?
Yes.
And right away, or the blues solo.
Well, that's what I'm saying. But I'm like, you said tell, that, like, you know, yeah, but yeah.
But someone, that stylistically, you could, that just goes to show, like, right away that solo stood out.
Yeah.
It was different than the rest somehow.
Certainly was.
Because it was, like, a more, like, rock and roll.
Yeah, it had that.
Type solo.
I've heard that before, like, ba-na, na-na-na-na-na. Like, that, I feel like that's just kind of, you know.
Yep.
It's just an awesome. It's a it's
straight
a
up.
Cool,
yeah, I didn't have any specific notes. It's like Joe said. It's
a good song.
Yeah, I'm definitely going back to that one. That's a good one.
Okay, Winter of Souls is the King Arthur song. So, long stories told here. Well, first of all, Winter of Souls. What do you make of that title?
People die in the winter.
Maybe? I don't know the story, the whole story of King Arthur very well.
Yeah.
I
don't either.
So I can't. This is my least favorite song on the album.
I thought it was great. I liked it.
It sounded more like Iced Earth to me. It would sound like a song that should have been sung by, or been played by Iced Earth. I don't know why. It's a great song. It's just my least favorite on the album.
Right.
In the lyrics, in higher lights, we seem to drown. We hold the key, but not the crown. that to me was talk is cheap. It's easy to know what the answers are, but to actually do it. You know, everybody knows how to live nobly, but you know what I mean? Like,
things are simple. They're not easy.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
So contextually, again, I would need to know more about the whole King Arthur story, I guess. But I like that lyric. And then, yeah.
I don't know why I like the line, conceived of his greed in a harsh reality. Because, isn't that, what most, look at any human that's, not doing well.
Sure.
And what are the two, recurring themes in their life? Greed and they've lived fucking hard knocks.
Yeah.
School
yeah.
of hard knocks. It's what it is. It's a good, I thought that was a good line. I don't know why that stuck with me.
When life punches you in the face.
Yeah.
Well, and then at the end, it's war will take place at dawn. There's no choice. It's all fate. You know what I mean? His path has kind of led him here. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That's
his destiny.
So that's it. Yeah. Yeah. Obviously, war is not a good idea. But again, you know, with his hard knock life and his father's lust and all that, you know, what else is he going to do?
Yeah. What was that all about? His father's.
Well, again, I think that's getting more into the specifics of the story, you know, which I'm not sure about.
King Arthur's father?
King Arthur
is the father.
King Arthur and Mordred. So, yeah, okay. I'm not sure if it's King Arthur who's referencing his father
right.
or what, but yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. I'm not certain how that really rolls. I'm assuming
it's
Mordred.
That kind of threw me off. That was, yeah.
But I really don't know.
So then
Disney didn't go into that part of
no.
yeah.
some knowledge from it.
I haven't seen that movie in a while.
So then with the Whistler and the Pied Piper and all that, what's the, cause those kind of epic stories always have a kind of a larger,
like a meaning.
Yeah. So what's
archetypical, what's it called? Archetype.
Aesop's
fable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't screw. If you screw me, I'm going to screw you kind of thing.
Yeah. Honor your,
honor your
commitments. Agreements. Yeah.
Yeah. Your agreements. Yeah.
Obviously the,
I mean, he says it. You should consider you might fail.
Yeah.
I mean, he says it right there. You know, you might not win this one. And what are the consequences of your action?
Yeah, it's a lack of forethought.
Yeah.
I'm just not going to pay this guy. That'll be fine. You know what I mean? Okay, well,
for us and
guess
we
what?
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to have rats eat your children.
Yeah.
No big deal. Don't pay me. It's okay, people.
Yeah, what is he? Watch your step. I'll bring the end.
Yeah, yeah. I like that one.
You know, and the idea that once you get rid of that generation of children, what else is left?
Yeah.
That's, I will destroy you.
All right.
Tear Down the Wall is awesome.
One more side to go, and then the amazing instrumental track Etching on the D side. So.
Silent.
Try to see what happens if you put the needle on it.
Destroy it.
Etching. Oh, we heard
no,
it!
No, it's designed in such a perfect way that the needle tearing across the record completes the etching.
Oh my god!
The disc starts glowing, rips a portal into hell.
It's all gonna happen here.
A holographic
at Rick and Knight podcast.
A holographic image of the fiddler pops up.
Yeah,
that'd be cool.
You fell.
I paid you, fiddler.
Yeah.
Jake, take a look at the album art. I don't know if you've looked at it at all.
Yeah, it's pretty epic. I like the.
Oh shit! It's Death playing the fiddle.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's that
he's
song.
He's the fiddler, man.
You got the
mm-hmm.
girl.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Sick.
And then flip it over, you'll see the staircase. What? Where the staircase leads you?
I like that thing on the right, that skull with the two. I don't know. Looks like two people hanging on a cross.
Yeah. Jesus.
Look, it's two
there.
Jesuses.
Yeah, two Jesuses.
No, no.
No, I'm joking. It's
okay.
Jesus and that guy that was on the cross
Wonderful.
With him.
Wonderful. I'm so happy.
No, I know.
Not everybody knew that story.
What is this? On the back.
What is it that you're looking at? Is that
the
graveyard?
Back. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
If you look at the lyrics page, same thing. You got this stuff going on. It's the graveyard. Little stuff going on here. You got the fiddler kicking it with some little ghost girl. The ghost girl, yes, the ghost girl.
The image, just the image of the Reaper itself is
isn't that a great, great
yeah,
image?
Man,
who made that? I'd be interested in doing research, who first conceived, the Reaper?
Oh, dude, that's what's
the hooded
with the
man.
The sickle and the hooded, with no face, he's got no, a lot of times he's got no face.
John Schaefer, the guitarist.
Yeah, he's pretty.
In a cemetery.
He's pretty awesome guitar player.
Yeah, so it's also Jim Morris, additional lead guitars.
Yeah, Mr. Hans. That's
wait, so how do you...
Jim Morrison?
His name is Hans? Or Hansi?
I thought it was Hansi. This says okay. Hans in here, but I don't know. I really don't know.
It okay. Could be a German nickname or
yeah.
something.
Yeah, so his name is Hansi Kursch. John Schaefer, as you mentioned. So those are the two main guys. But then, Jim Morris, additional lead guitars, and Mark Prater on the drums.
Dude, that double kick drum.
Yeah.
Dude, yeah, the motorcycle drums, as are so familiar in metal music.
Motorcycle drums, there you go.
So Hansi Kurt, I mean, so he's the only vocalist. So they're just like layering his vocal every time we hear more voices and stuff because there's nobody else listed as
you know
a
what?
Vocal on here.
Yes, I thought I heard John Schaefer in one of the songs for like just him saying something. It didn't sound like Hansi. I want to say it was in Winter of Souls maybe.
Mm. So even when they do like those choir parts, like where it sounds like it's like a church choir, that's him?
Yeah, Hansi does a lot of overlapping. Wow. So he'll record his voice and overlap it.
That's impressive.
That's why I just have to give a shout out to his new album, The Twilight Orchestra, Legacy of the Dark Lands. He trained specifically more like operatic and did a lot of voice training for this one. And you hear that same like throughout all of his CDs, he did a lot with the layering and his voice was, you know, he always focused on range and the ability to kind of tell a story through his tone. But his new album is like that plus 10.
Yeah.
It's just the
tits. That refinement. Yeah.
Yes. You can tell, like, it's just like, wow, this is the culmination of his career.
Yeah.
So I'm really looking forward to the Demons and Wizards next album.
He's a really good vocalist, man. It's he's a range, quite a range, you know, because like he had a like Fiddler on the Green, a few other songs too, really measured, kind of like really nice vocal, but then obviously he can turn it
absolutely
up when he needs to.
You know what I was thinking of listening to these past few songs? I don't know why, but just right when the first song on this side started, I was thinking of Rime of the Ancient Mariner. God.
Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Such a great song.
And then came the race.
So I have to say that the 15 minute long solo, and it's just the boat rocking.
Oh yeah. You guys remember that, right?
Yeah.
From Iron Maiden.
Iron Maiden. Okay. I couldn't. I knew, but I couldn't think of it.
Iron Maiden about the cursed boat because the guy kills that albatross. And Mother Nature, like, curses the boat.
You can't do that.
Can't kill the albatross, man.
You can't kill
man.
The albatross.
Why would you want to kill an albatross?
I don't know.
Like, if I come back... this is being said.
Okay.
And recorded. If I have a choice to come back as any one living organism on Earth...
Be an albatross?
It'd be an albatross. And if I died learning how to fly as an albatross, because that happens very often, because they're big and goofy, and there's a lot of sharks around where they... Then I want to come back as an albatross until I learn how to fly for miles without flapping my wings. And so on and so forth.
Okay.
Hope the what was that, Buddhism? The Buddhist gods heard me on that one.
Okay.
Reincarnation. Reincarnation, there you go. Reincarnate me.
You are Atman.
I am Atman. The mighty albatross.
So we'll start the C-set here. They were, you know... 16 years ahead of their time, directing this song called Tear Down the Wall. Well,
well, it depends on which wall we're talking about.
Yeah, here. I guess it's the Berlin Wall, I guess, would be more relevant, but, you know.
Maybe they're talking, I mean.
It'd be like a...
He is a very spectacular wizard. So they actually got the name Demons and Wizards. I believe it was John Schaefer's wife. Would jokingly say, you know, the demon and angel, and Hansi would have the joke. Oh, I'm no angel, baby. I'm a wizard. If anything, I'm a wizard.
That's funny.
And so they got the, you know, demons and wizards from that. Because John Schaefer is, I mean, Iced Earth, much more
like biblical.
No, they have like Disciples of the Lie and things like that. They have much more. Maybe more biblical songs, but they're just a little bit harder.
Mm-hmm.
They're even if you look up any one of their album arts, it's like Eddie,
mm-hmm.
but a little bit more gruesome.
Mm-hmm.
So it's things along those lines.
Like organs hanging out and shit.
Yeah. So you know, but it's fantastic otherwise. And they also sing similar context where it's like really hard songs, and they have these beautiful, like, they sung a gorgeous song about 9/11, I think it was.
Hmm.
You know, but it's very, you know, mellow and sweet. And John Schaefer has a good voice, too, for certain things. That's why when I was listening to Winter of Souls, I'm like, I think John Schaefer should be singing this song based on how it sounds in the background. Mm. Like,
yeah.
But that doesn't matter. Tear down the wall.
All right. Tear down the wall.
This is a really interesting song. I hope you guys know this one.
Gallows Pole. Led Zeppelin has a song called Gallows Pole.
Really?
Yep.
I wonder how it matches up.
Let's see.
Google Translate.
Yeah. this is the only song not written by Hansi Kursch. I don't know who wrote it, but somebody else wrote it.
Oh, nice. I know the song. Cool.
Thank you.
All right, so perhaps Joe looked it up. I don't know if he did or not. Any guesses on who the song is by originally?
Oh, yeah, it's by Cream.
Okay, yeah.
Eric Clapton.
Yeah. Cool cover, man. I did not expect that.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I was not expecting a cover in this. If you told me, oh, yeah, there's going to be a Cream cover in this album, I'd be like, I don't know. But no, they did it well. They played it really well.
So, yeah, I'd be interested to hear the original. Cause
you've heard the original.
Okay. Yeah, I just didn't recognize it.
It's a famous song.
Wow. So that end of it got really concept-y. It was almost as if like they were all the same song there for a minute.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
There were about three songs that like went all together.
Yep.
At least, if not the whole thing. But what? Oh, yeah. No. So it was right from the jump. So Tear Down the Wall had that same, like, bum, 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 bum. Like, it had almost the same, and then Gallows probably did the exact same thing.
Yep.
That was cool.
Yeah. Tear Down the Wall was very quick, very, very short song, but it was very, like, hard-hitting, very, it was a good song.
So if you follow Tear Down the Wall, Gallows Pole, My Last mm-hmm. Sunrise, they're very, like, abstract.
Uh-huh.
I've always considered Gallows Pole being from the perspective of the Gallows Pole.
From the actual,
yeah,
like the idea, like what it was alive, like,
not the person on the pole, or
right,
in the gallows.
The person on the pole, like,
okay.
Endless stairs, like walking up to the gallows, the gallows lights. So, like, there's a light attached to the pole, and a light's supposed to feel warm. It's like a lantern, but the idea is like, no, we're taking you up the stairs because you're gonna get hung right there.
Right, it's a very chilling, cold.
So, like, something that should be warm and comforting is just not warm and comforting.
Wow.
Interesting.
That's how I don't know if that's the case. That's how I always listen to it. I've seen all life die. Like, it's just the idea, the archetype of misery.
Definitely different from the Zeppelin's version of their Gallows Pole. It's like, that song's about, like, the guy in the gallows pleading, like, basically saying, just wait for my brother and sister to come and he'll tell you everything. So it's like this, like, it's like a battle against time kind of thing.
Interesting.
But it's coming from the perspective of the person, not of the actual gallows, which is an interesting take.
The pole.
Yes.
Like, am I evil? Am I good? Madness, existence, faith, and greed. Like, that's...
Am I doing a service or am I...
Right.
Just, like killing these people for...
I'm just the means to an end, and am I doing the right thing? It depends on the perspective.
Well, there's immediate double meaning there in terms of the light. It's supposed to be warm, but it's cold, like following a false
light.
Absolutely. You know what I mean? Like,
interesting.
That's probably a more more accurate interpretation of what they're trying to convey.
Yeah.
Yeah, a different point of view.
Led Zeppelin version, you mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Jakers?
No comment.
I tear down the wall.
Yeah.
Okay. Gallows Pole opened with the same kind of ominous sort of guitar, like in the background, as it was before in Fiddler.
Yep.
John Schaefer plays a real ominous guitar. I encourage you guys to listen to any Eister song. You'll hear a very, like, mellow, doomy, like.
It's just cool. The mood.
Conveying that mood.
The mood that it. Yeah. Yeah, just with a guitar.
Chant? What did you guys think of the lyrics of Chant?
You just skipped over My Last Sunrise? What the hell? Don't skip it. You know I wanted to say. God isn't real. That's what that song's about.
Wait, what? Gallows Pole?
No,
next My one. Last
Sunrise. Oh, okay.
I don't know what Golgotha is. Does anybody look that up a chance?
It's where Jesus died.
Yeah.
The name of the hill he was hung on.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah.
So from the perspective of the hill...
Which makes sense.
Okay.
Nothing happened here.
He's yeah.
Like, he might not even have been a carpenter.
Yeah. He saw a carpenter die, but maybe not even that. Yeah.
Like, it's just completely, like, downplays the whole story.
Is that why Jesus is missing in the album art?
Everything but Jesus. No, he's there. It's Jesus and his buddy, remember?
No, there was Jesus and his two buddies. They weren't his buddies. They were thieves.
It was two Jesuses.
No, it was... Jesus Christ. Oh, it was Jesus and Christ. You're absolutely right. No, it was Jesus and two, what were they?
Apostles?
No, not apostles. There were two thieves. One was...
Oh.
One was...
Barabbas! Oh, no, that's the guy that they left. That they lived.
I think one of them was, like, repenting, and the other one was like,
I don't
sucks.
Give a fuck,
yeah. Yeah, like, fuck you. What's your name, just so I can take it in vain? He was the first dude that took the Lord's name in vain. Yep, that was the guy.
Bastard.
Son of a bitch. You don't say that about Mary. She was a nice lady.
The lamb. Wait, guess what? The lamb, the rose, they don't exist.
They don't exist.
So take her name in vain.
Well, that's not what my shirt here says. 100% wool. Disagrees.
Okay, so what's the sacrificial lamb, right?
Yeah.
Rose, what's the rose represent here?
Purity, love.
Okay.
Or maybe a rose those is are, just a rose.
Those are the lamb, the rose are actually like
a biblical
like reference. Imagery. Yeah. It means something specific.
See, again, I feel like if we were familiar with the Bible, it would make a lot of sense. Yeah. But it's like, no, it, no. what is he talking about here?
Well, he just says, yeah.
I think it's pronounced Bibble.
This is like almost like, in these are my last words. I need a rest. Maybe he's dying and he's coming. Like, maybe this is perspective of a guy who's like going to die. And maybe his
final message. Funny,
maybe that, because like a lot of people, like what they'll do when they're going to die is they have this religious
sure experience
repentance or want to go find God now that they're close to death,
right? But
this is the opposite. Like he's a faith, like maybe this to me sounds like the opposite, like a guy who's been religious all his life and is close to death and is like, this is all bullshit, like my last message is only fucking you, like make the most of it. You know what I mean?
Live life. Enjoy it.
Yeah, well, it's not clear the way, like, the lyrics came out, but it seemed like there's conflict at the end, right? Like, it's saying, like, hear no evil, speak no evil, see no evil, feel no evil. But then, like, in the background, like, it's saying all I see and hear is evil.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like those were overlapped. I could be mistaken, absolutely. But there was, like, just a conflict there on his deathbed, I guess, if you will.
Shitty deathbed.
Yeah. Pick a lane, man.
Put a fucking pillow over my head if I start talking like that.
All right, well, all that's left is the side D, etching. Yeah.
Throw it on there, see what happens.
Ruin the record.
Wow. All
right, well, overall thoughts. I mean,
great. I liked it a lot.
Glad you guys enjoyed it. I'm really looking forward to their new album. They released one song so far, and it's pretty tits. I mean, after 15 years of a little hiatus, I'm happy to hear what they have to come out with.
Were they doing other things in that 15 years, like doing other bands and other projects?
Oh, yeah.
Other...
Hans came out with Legacy of the Dark Lands, his 20-year project. Yeah. And I don't know if Ice Earth came out anything recent. I don't follow them as closely.
Okay.
But I haven't heard of Ice Earth coming out with anything recent, so maybe no.
Just laying low.
Yeah.
You should listen to Oceans of Slumber. You would like that band a lot.
I think you've mentioned Oceans of Slumber because I had, when I was typing in something for Oceans, it came up in my Google search history.
Yeah, because Google knows. Google knows your preferences.
If I had searched it on YouTube, I bet I have songs with like the little red bar.
Las Vegas has a Oceans of Slumber reaction. Should look it up.
Yeah.
They're another band that's kind of like this. That'd be a cool record to bring. I was actually contemplating, before I decided on Tom Morello, that's the record I was going to bring.
That's Oceans of Slumber.
Yeah, it's the Winter is the album. A lot of, isn't it interesting, like Ice Earth in here, there's imagery of ice. Like, their album's called Winter.
Like, Oceans lots of Slumber, of like...
I get, that's a lot of like old, like medieval imagery, like...
Sure, they're,
like,
yeah.
Game of Thrones, like...
Winter is coming.
Yeah,
this sort of stuff tends to be the most symbolic, for sure.
Beneath These Waves is my favorite song in the other album, and it's very
interesting.
Very that strong imagery of like you're beneath the waves,
oceans of slumber.
It's deep.
Mm.
Ooh.
It all ties in.
You see? It's here. Under the floor.
They're Blind Guardian is my favorite band by far, and Demon, it's fantastic to be able to have like a side project like Demons and Wizards available like for intermittent like little gems of great tunes. And Hans, as a lyricist and as well known as he is in like this genre of music, he's requested in so many different songs by so many different artists. And so it's really cool to just like, hey, that's Hans. Mm-hmm. Ed Guy is a real fuck. He's a real fuck. super power metal. Like, I'm sure he's a nice guy. I don't know if he's a nice guy. I saw him in concert once by accident. He wore a pink scarf in his back pocket, and he smelled like perfume. I was up at the front, and he smelled very pretty. It was very awkward. I think Into Eternity was the next band, so it made up for it, but fucking weird. But he started a new power metal band called Avantasia, and the only song that I like, it's Raven Child. I was listening to it like it came on a YouTube recommended thing, and I was just listening. And the instant they start, I'm like, hey, it's fucking Hansi. And it was
Hansi,
you know, was the lyricist or the main singer of the song. So it's just cool to see that stuff. It sucks that he played with Ed Guy. Fucking Ed Guy. Pink bananas and pretty smells. Goddamn unicorn.
I will say just about this kind of music in general, I really like folk kind of narrative driven music. And again, I mean, these guys just take it to a new level, man. It's all these different stories and stuff like that. It's very interesting. I don't know if there's another genre of music that's really that focused on story.
That's kind of power metal. Power metal is like dragons it and is. Wizards and
like even like you guys stories. Were talking about the I forget the name of the song.
Focused.
Iron Maiden. I don't know the
Rime of the Ancient Mariner.
Yes, Rime of the Ancient Mariner. I mean that's a whole like.
Hear the rhyme of the ancient murder.
But what were you talking about with the boat solo with the boat rocking?
Oh yeah, and it's like 15 minutes, and it's just like.
And it's not really a solo.
And like a narrator.
Okay,
comes
well
in.
Yeah, but that's
the crazy part. That's like the narrator comes in, one by one, the dead bodies roll from the decks.
Just like a droll background of like a like the guitar is just like
he's playing like a weird synth like keyboard like,
yeah that's what it is, it's a keyboard. It's fucking weird. They played that in concert.
Oh yeah, they do all the time.
It's like that part of it.
Yeah.
And that was when everybody lit up their joints.
Oh yeah, and they
like,
do the smoke machine.
Solid 15.
Dude, they do the smoke machine. A dense fog lying on the deck. And like like the fog machine goes and the whole thing is like there's like a red glow in the background, like pulsing green.
You know
and
how
red.
To put on a show, man.
It's that's fucking cool. Awesome.
So the other album I was gonna bring, the other option I had was a Blind Guardian album, and it was Nightfall in Middle Earth, and the entire album is about the prequel to Lord of the Rings, the Silmarillion. Every song is about like a different, and it is.
Yeah,
you know, it really ties in well to their newest one, which is all about like the sequel to an actual book written by, you know, Hans and the author, which is pretty cool.
And he writes books too?
No. The author and Hans collaborated to write this album to like as a sequel to the first book that this author wrote that he wasn't going to write a sequel to.
Dang.
And so
that's crazy.
Like the author wrote annotations for each song, like this is what's happening and this is what this means.
Oh, sick.
And there'll be like a 45-second little interlude where it's like the dwarf of the Red Tower, the gnome of the Red Tower talking and like going mad.
Mm.
And it's 45 seconds of that going into the next song. Like, all right, we're at the top of the tower. We have to kill the dwarf or kill the gnome.
Yeah.
You know, so it's cool. It's pretty cool in that regard.
Well, that's another interesting aspect is they're upfront about like what the stories are about too, because other music obviously is... that has a narrative, but like The only other guy I know, like Randy Newman, will like say what his songs are about before he plays them, but like other musicians are totally against that.
Right.
Like don't
they like to keep it like a mystery, and you, you just take it to your own interpretation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you see is that's what it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Both are awesome approaches, and they
yeah.
It's great that both are an option.
Mystery and truth.
Yeah. Say that. Like sometimes you want to read a book instead of solve a mystery. You know what I mean?
Perfect.
There both are fun.
But all right. Any other housekeeping wrap up thoughts?
That's it for me. Another good record night in the books, gentlemen.
Yeah. So if you didn't like the music, look at the art. You might.
Yeah. But they bring a lot to the table, whether it's music, lyrics, or album art.
Yeah.
They're strong in the album art department. Is there any, do you guys have a favorite album as far as like the artwork is concerned?
You gotta.
Iron Maiden.
You have to say some Iron Maiden. Album. There's no way you can't.
Eddie, awesome. Fucking Number of the Beast. Eddie, their mascot, has the devil on puppet strings.
Eddie. Rage Against the Machine's first album with the burning monk.
Oh yeah. And that's just a real picture
that's
too.
Like
an image. You know what I mean?
It was the photo of the year for that year of 90.
From my own personal collection, it tends to be I like Sturgill's records. Those are interesting. But as far as Atmosphere, the When Life Gives You Lemons, You Paint That Shit Gold, the storybook. That was a cool...
Oh, yeah.
I
forgot about that.
Oh, yeah. That was cool.
And then one we haven't gotten to, I think it's maybe the Childish Gambino record that Max got.
Yes.
There's a lot going on there. Like, we'll have to look. We'll get to that. Eventually, Max will guest on the show, and we'll do that record. But
That's going to be a good record. Next.
Yeah. All right. That wraps it up. Thank you for listening to the Record Night Podcast. If you're listening on YouTube, please like this video and subscribe to the channel if you're so inclined. If you have suggestions for an album you think we should listen to, please leave a comment below. Or if you're interested in reaching out to the podcast, you can do so at recordnightpodcast@gmail.com. For Jake, Joe, and Kyle, I'm Colin. Once again, thank you for listening.
Jake made me so fucking mad, I can't stand it!